Previously on The Lost Kids.
We all got together because we knew he was leaving. And we were sitting there at that counter in that kitchen. And we just kept saying to him, if anything goes wrong, you call me.
Then that Friday, we talked. And right away, Daniel was really upset. You don't even know this is a really best school. I don't want to stay. Really best school.
A staff calls that said Daniel ran away. We report that to the police. The mistake we have is that I sent him to CEDU. We didn't know that it's such a bad school, and we were fooled by them.
Tell me about what you remember of Daniel Ewan.
I was on what they called an escort duty, and I remember trying to engage him into conversation and sort of explain that every new student feels some sadness or anger.
This is Erica Kaplan-Isaac. She was already a student at CEDU Running Springs in California when Daniel Ewan arrived in February 2004.
I usually said things like, you know, it's going to be okay. This program is hard, but it's survivable. You're going to get through this. You're going to make friends. It's not as bad as it seems. Just sort of trying to build up that person and get them out of this sad funk.
Erica spoke to Daniel in the cafeteria of the main lodge, a room with huge windows overlooking the San Bernardino Mountains, a view they called the backside.
He said literally nothing. He sat completely silent. Most students would bargain or cry, or there would be some sort of grief processing, but Daniel just sat there totally silently and would not speak a word to me.
Daniel may have been quiet, but he was preparing to run. And despite what staff at CEDU were telling his parents, that he was happy and doing well, staff knew he was a flight risk. According to depositions from former staff and residents, part of a lawsuit the Ewans later filed, Daniel had been punished for breaking rules. He was forbidden from communicating with his peers, and he was being monitored by older residents like Erica, so he wouldn't take off.
Students ran away all the time. Usually it was a few months into their stay. They would get into trouble or do something or become overwhelmed, and they would sneak off in the middle of the night, usually.
On the morning of the day that Daniel disappeared, less than 2 weeks after he arrived at CEDU, he was caught trying to leave the campus with a backpack full of food. Another resident restrained him. Later that day, he was assigned to sweep a deck near the main lodge. The resident who was monitoring him at the time says he turned away for a moment, and when he looked back, Daniel was gone. It wasn't unusual for kids to run away from CEDU. In fact, it was disconcertingly common. Between 1997 and 2005, the San Bernardino police say they took 341 reports of juvenile runaways from CEDU. They don't have records from the first 30 years of the program. But this is an astonishing number, considering just how small the student body was. For example, in the 1999-2000 school year, there were only about 70 kids in the program. Usually, kids were brought back within a matter of hours or days. But there are cases where kids were never found. In 1993, there was a 17-year-old named John Inman. And then the following year, a 14-year-old disabled boy named Blake Pursley was seen limping away to a barn at night. Investigators followed his footprints off the property to a paved road, where his tracks disappeared. And then there was Daniel. As days turned into weeks, among the kids at CEDU, stories began to circulate.
I think it may have been a few weeks later, there was a rumor started that Daniel had made it down the backside of the mountain and had joined a gang in San Diego and was never, like, wasn't going to come back.
A new term was coined among the kids at CEDU. Running from the campus and making it to the city became known as pulling a Daniel.
He was a myth. He was legendary in a lot of ways. And for me, I felt I don't know, kind of scared for him.
I'm Josh Bloch. And this is The Lost Kids, a podcast from UCP Audio. Episode 2, Pulling a Daniel.
Oh my God.
Watch, because I mean, like, broken ankle. All these. Oh. Okay, I think if we, what do you think about going straight right now?
Yeah. Melissa is another former resident of CEDU. It's a snow-covered day, like the one when Daniel went missing in 2004. And together, we're trying to find the site of the old CEDU campus.
It feels so weird to be going, trying to get to CEDU and not away.
Melissa hasn't been anywhere near this place since the 90s, when her parents sent her to CEDU. It used to be that getting to CEDU was the easy part. But CEDU Runnings Springs is closed now, and the new owners have gated off the property. The only way to get a glimpse of the old campus is by bushwhacking up the side of the mountain.
Yeah, this way?
Or should we go down?
Let's go around.
Yeah, because okay, then we're going to have to go back up.
We have to grab onto tree branches and boulders to stop from sliding backwards.
This is kind of thorny.
Whoa.
One theory about how Daniel escaped CEDU is that he tried running down the backside of the property, basically where we're standing right now. Right away, it strikes me how isolated we are, how dangerous it would be for a 17-year-old kid to be standing out here in the snow, facing the elements, without provisions.
You see how you can get into this mess? Like, you could really go far and then be like, whoa, whoa, I've gone too far.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Because we are going to have to go back through this.
If there's anyone who knows about what it takes to escape CEDU, it's Melissa. She tried running away 8 times over the course of a year and a half. And for reasons that will become clear, she only tried pulling a Daniel, escaping down the backside of the mountain, once. I'm worried that we're not going to be able to see much. We're basically walking through the clouds. But the weather changes fast here. And as we reach the top of a ridge, the afternoon sun breaks through, and we can see for miles.
Oh, look, it's starting to clear this way.
Wow.
Okay, this is it.
There it
yep,
is.
Yep.
It's been 25 years since Melissa has seen this place.
We are looking down on the CEDU property, and we can see the lodge right here on the right. We've got a pretty high vantage point, probably, 40 feet up? And you can see the roof and kind of the front facade.
Perched on the side of the mountain, the property looks like a fancy ski chalet. At one point, it belonged to Hollywood star Walter Houston, Angelica Houston's grandfather. The main lodge has wooden shingle siding and a giant stone chimney. The pool and tennis court sit in the middle of the 76-acre property. The only time I've seen this place has been in old CEDU brochures and promotional videos from the 1980s. When Melissa saw those brochures as a kid, she says she was actually excited by the idea of coming here. But it didn't take long for her to start looking for escape routes.
You know, it's funny to look at the pool because that was so not a memory. Because we didn't use it. It was just sitting there.
Like others, she quickly discovered a very different reality.
And so that main building, that main lodge there, has a lot of memories.
Yes.
In it, hey?
Yeah, a lot.
How much you're holding back on me when you say you're giving all.
When Melissa first stepped into the lodge, music was playing on the loudspeakers.
They were the same songs, same artists that played over and over. And we weren't allowed to talk about other kinds of music. We only had a few select ones that were okay, and they were playing on the loudspeaker. John Denver, Simon and Garfunkel, Crosby, Stills and Nash. Who sings Tell It All, Brother? Who sings that?
Kenny Rogers.
I mean, some of the music that played, the messages behind it was so, it just added to everything that we were doing, like, tell it all, brother. Like, we were supposed to tell everything. There was no boundary for anything about you.
Telling it all, Melissa would soon discover, was one of the most important parts of CEDU's attempt to help kids, and preferably, to tell it loud.
Tell it all, brother. Before we fall, tell it all, brothers and sisters. Tell it all, brother. Tell it all.
Melissa grew up in the southern U.S., as you can probably tell by her accent. She was athletic. She was into sports and cheerleading, and she also had an active social life.
Maybe a little bit too social, because I was not studious. I did not like to study. I probably didn't have the discipline that I needed to do that.
Melissa's story fits a pattern for a lot of kids who ended up at CEDU. Like Daniel Ewan, she was not doing hard drugs or getting into trouble with the law. But by her junior year, her grades were sliding, and her mother wasn't sure what to do. In fact, her mom was overwhelmed. She was caring for Melissa's stepdad, who was dying. The final straw came one night when Melissa was out with friends. She was drinking. And she called her mom to pick her up because it was past her curfew and she didn't want to drive home.
And she said no. And so I said, well, I'm going to stay. I'm not going to drink and drive. So I did stay the night. And I was with a guy, and they, you know, it's kind of normal for girls and boys to like each other in teenagers, you know, it was a big mistake. Kind of sealed my fate.
3 months later, she was in a CEDU van on a narrow highway winding its way up the San Bernardino Mountains.
I mean, I don't know if it was the driver and the way he spoke mixed with the drive itself, which, you know, you feel like you're about to fall off the side of the mountain, and it just didn't feel like we were driving up to a nice little spot. You know, a 17-year-old just didn't belong there in that position, driving up this mountain to nowhere, that far away from her parents, to stay with strangers.
When Melissa arrived at CEDU, her suitcase was inspected for jewelry, photographs, or any clothing that was black or fluorescent or had a logo on it. The CEDU uniform was essentially white or beige polo shirts tucked into khaki pants. Melissa was assigned a big sister, and for what felt like hours, the rules were explained to her, what CEDU staff called agreements. No drugs, no sex, no violence. How to wear your hair, how to tuck in your shirt, when you're allowed to eat, who you can and can't talk to, and the music that was forbidden to listen to or even talk about. She was also introduced to some of the strange jargon of CEDU. If you broke a rule, you were out of agreement. You'd be required to keep a dirt list, basically a list of rules you'd broken. Your peers would be monitoring you, and you'd have to monitor them to make sure you were being honest. If you were out of agreement, a staff member might choose to prohibit you from associating with certain people. That's called being put on bans. Bans could last for weeks or even months. Punishment could also include being confined to sit at a table for days on end, epic writing assignments, and physical work like digging a hole and filling it up again, or moving a pile of rocks back and forth.
I was so confused and felt so alone that I just laid on my bed and cried. And I also still remember one girl coming up and just kind of rubbing my back while I cried.
Melissa quickly learned the shape of a day. Unless they were being punished, in the morning, kids would attend classes often taught by counselors who weren't trained as teachers. They would have to do some kind of chores on campus. There were set meal times. The evenings were full of disclosure. You'd make an appointment with another staff or a resident and share your life story. But first and foremost, CEDU Runnings Springs calls itself a therapeutic boarding school. And one of the defining activities were these group counseling sessions that happened every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday. They're called wraps. That's where you'd have to tell it all.
You know, fuck you, Kevin! You know, ever since I fucking can remember, I've been fucking trying to prove to you! You know, I fucking like you as a fucking person! You know, I don't know what I have to do, I fucking try, I fucking say myself, I shouldn't do it.
This recording is from what was called an encounter therapy session at another so-called troubled teen program with some similarities to CEDU. What you're hearing is residents verbally attacking each other until they disclose or confess their innermost secrets, the things that they're most ashamed of, the rules they've broken, and the emotions that they've held back. When someone's in the hot seat, everyone in the group is expected to weigh in. The room gets very loud.
You know, fuck you! You know, I'm sick of your fucking asshole! You know, what does this fucking house have to do to prove to you? You know, nobody cares if you fucking scratch your fucking arm!
This stream of profanities, the screaming. Melissa says this is what a rap session at CEDU sounded like. But at CEDU, it went even further. During rap sessions, participants would be instructed to verbally attack one person relentlessly, to the point where that person would get so worked up and emotional, they'd end up screaming into the floor. They called this running your anger. Running your anger is better known as primal scream therapy, and it was popular in the 70s. This example is not from CEDU, it's from the 1973 documentary Primal Therapy, In Search of the Real You. It was these rap sessions that made Melissa bolt from the program the first time.
It was just full-on interrogation for 4 hours, an aggressive, very, very aggressive confrontation and interrogations, and it was like a pressure cooker in that room. I was just listening to everything and in just absolute shock and horrified. And I sat there and took it all in and was terrified, like primal fear, terrified, like for my life. I thought I needed to get out of that room and fast and off that campus. Like it was a big, like my life is being threatened, fear. And so I waited until they did like kind of a debriefing where they went around the room and asked each person how they feel. And they got to me and I literally said, if I have to walk across this country, I'm going home. And I meant it.
Melissa walked out of that room, grabbed her winter boots, and walked out the main gate and down the road.
Nobody followed, and I just kept walking, and I walked towards the road.
Walking off the CEDU campus wasn't that hard. Staff often point out that there were no locks, no fences. There was, however, several feet of snow on the ground, and since Melissa didn't want to get spotted by passing cars, she went about 50 feet into the woods and hugged the road.
Then it started to get dark and cold, and I started to get very afraid, and realized that this is just not going to happen. You know, I don't have anything that I need to even spend one night out here. And so at that point, I went up to the top of the road and walked along and just hoped that a policeman would drive by. And he did, and he picked me up and took me back to CEDU.
Well, how did it feel to arrive back on that campus again?
Very, very defeating and scary, and like, I need to talk to my mom. I need to talk to my mom. I need to tell her, like, I have got to come home. She's got to understand that I need to get home. But you know, you couldn't talk to them, but every 2 weeks, you had somebody sitting across from you, monitoring your phone call. It was a 10-minute phone call. What I was left to do is just beg to come home, and it was just completely ineffective.
Melissa realized that if she was going to get out of this place, she would have to try and run away again. But first, she needed the snow to melt. And in the meantime, her life at CEDU just got harder and stranger. According to former staff and residents, running away was a serious offense. And one of the ways residents were punished was using a form of isolation they called a full-time. On a full-time, you were not allowed to go to classes or eat meals with your peers. You weren't allowed to talk or even look at anyone except for the person supervising you. And this could last for days, weeks, and sometimes even longer than a month.
You would sit at a dining room table kind of all day. You couldn't smile, you couldn't laugh, you couldn't, you know.
You couldn't smile.
That's what I remember. You couldn't make eye contact. So you were completely isolated and you sat at this dining room table. And when you weren't sitting at the table, you were either working, like chopping wood or digging a hole or, you know, physical work off by yourself somewhere on the campus. You know, if somebody came in with full time, that person was obviously going to be interrogated the worst.
Even when she wasn't being punished, Melissa was always on edge. She always felt like she was being watched by the other staff and residents, looking for any small infraction. Even inadvertent contact or a glance with someone of the opposite sex could become fodder for a rap session. Not only that, she was expected to be watching the other residents, to get dirt on them.
My cortisol levels were just out the roof going into a rap and through the rap. Just that fear of going in and just the unknown, you had no idea how it was going to play out. No idea. And there are a gazillion different ways those things played out.
It was more than half her lifetime ago that Melissa was at CEDU. And like numerous former residents, she's buried her memories of her time there. Most of her family doesn't even know she's come here to do this interview in California. She wants to remain anonymous. By the way, she chose that pseudonym, Melissa, because that was the name of her best friend back home. A friend who said she wrote her every day, but the letters never arrived because CEDU screened her mail.
It's a lot more fun to be doing this with people than by myself at 17.
In April, 4 months after Melissa arrived at CEDU, the snow was gone, and Melissa was ready to make a run for it again. Her plan? Hike down the mountain and into San Bernardino. Daniel Ewan would have just been a toddler at the time, so it was years before the term was coined. But Melissa was about to try what would later become known as pulling a Daniel. We stop for a moment. The rocks and brush cast long shadows in the afternoon sun. When you're looking down the backside, it looks as though the rolling landscape is covered in a thin layer of foliage. We can see San Bernardino in the distance, but get closer, and the terrain starts to look very different. Swaths of the mountain are covered in tangles of tall, thorny bushes and jagged rock. To get anywhere, you would need to pass through that. There are snakes, bears, bobcats. There are virtually no signs of human life down that backside, just a vast, uninviting landscape. If Daniel Ewan escaped this way, he also would have had to navigate this terrain.
Let's go find where you went down. I'm going to go retrace your steps.
Melissa watches as I try to make my way through a large shrub.
That is prickly as hell. I can't even get in. Did you walk through this?
Yes.
I mean, I'll take one step in there, but that's...
You have to, like...
I give up at pretty much the spot where Melissa's second escape began.
I don't know how far down. I want to say like maybe a third of the way down. I almost stepped on a snake. And, you know, I was trying to identify the snake. And it was frustrating because I thought I need to know my survival skills. But I also thought, you know, this is not good. I could have stepped on the snake. And if it were poisonous, I would have been this far down. So it was the first kind of sign of danger. But, you know, I had come from danger. Like, CEDU, to me, was danger. It was like every way. I couldn't turn any direction without danger. But I did think, I've really come too far at this point to turn back. And so I just kept going.
Melissa followed a stream. She stumbled onto an isolated road. She hoped the road would wind its way down to San Bernardino, but it kept veering the wrong way.
Well, I mean, it was getting dark, and so there was no walking in the dark. You think about, there's no flashlight or no lights back there at all. I mean, there's just no choice but to go to sleep. So, and it was
you know, warm and pretty during the day, but at night it was cold, very, very cold, and my feet were sore, and so I took my shirt and wrapped my feet. And, you know, as I did that, I kind of tucked myself a little away from the road because I thought, how in the world am I going to explain this if somebody were to drive by? I'm shirtless out here in the middle of nowhere. How am I going to explain this?
The next morning, Melissa decided to backtrack so she could follow the road the other direction, hoping it would take her towards some kind of civilization.
I never could find that stream again for some reason. And my water supply was gone. That was the end of any water. I just remember getting to this spot where the mountain up to my right. And I was hearing gunfire. You know, I started hearing somebody shooting a gun, and I really thought maybe it was a rifle range. And when I thought that, I thought, well, there would be people, multiple people. And so maybe there would be somebody there, even like whoever runs the rifle range, you know, somebody that can help me. So I started screaming for help. I mean, just screaming, help, help, really loud. And then it dawned on me, you know, it really was just one gun firing. And so that probably wasn't a very good idea. And so I stopped yelling help. And then pretty quick, you know, soon after, I heard and saw the bullet hit the tree right in front of me. And a little piece of bark fell. And it was right in front of me. So it was pretty clear that it was now aimed at me. And so I turned my head a little bit to try to look up the mountain, thinking that it could have been from... And then I heard a bullet just whiz by my head. And you can hear it loud.
You're being shot at. There's bullets whizzing by your head.
Yeah.
Tell me about the choice that now you're faced with someone firing a gun at you. Down there, you know, you have no water.
Yeah.
You can keep going into the desert with no water. You can sit there and get shot. Or you can turn around and go back to CEDU.
Or I can hide in the, but you like run and hide. I think the thing was I just didn't have the energy to panic. I was tired. I just didn't have it in me to have that fear. And my heart didn't even race. And I just decided to walk away. And the gunfire stopped.
There's no way to know where those bullets were coming from. But it was clear that the backside was not the best way to run from CEDU.
Even if you had like a week's supply of food and water, I just don't know how you would get anywhere.
Right. So the bullet actually changed.
I know. It kind of changed my course, and it ultimately probably saved my life, which is really a really weird realization. That night, I remember seeing up on the top of the mountain a window with where it looked like people were kind of walking around and maybe eating in a dining room, and it just looked so inviting.
Melissa says she was exhausted and dehydrated, but she so badly wanted to get to that dining room. She wanted nothing more than to knock on that door and ask for help.
When I went down the mountain, you know, I was going down the stream, and that was not very hard at all and kind of sped things up. But starting up that mountain, it was just painstakingly slow to get to that ridge. And I couldn't quite get there, because when I came up that other side of the ridge and made it, I guess, 3/4 of the way up, I just gave out. And it was really mostly being dehydrated more than anything. I just really, really needed some water. And so I laid down on that other side of the ridge and just kept coming and going And I still don't know if I had a night there or not, but I just remember the sun kind of glaring on me. And I remember, you know, writing, "I love you, Mom," in the dirt, which is so pitiful. But I thought I was going to die right there. And I just didn't have anything left in me.
A few months before, Melissa was a fairly ordinary teenager. She got in trouble with her parents because she missed her curfew and slept over at a boy's house. And here she was, lying down on the side of a mountain, preparing to die.
And as I was laying there, it dawned on me that I could be eaten out there and my bones would be there. There's no way anybody would find bones right there underneath all that brush. And I just kind of decided to keep trying to get to that ridge. It was just make it 5 to 6, 7 feet and then collapse back down and just over and over, rest a little bit and then over and over kind of do that until I could, until I made it back to this house that I saw before, which turned out to be CEDU.
Melissa had become so disoriented and turned around. She was back where she started, at CEDU.
You've got to be kidding me. I can't get away from this place. You know, I can't get away from this place.
Strangely, at first, no one reacted to her return. Melissa walked to a bathroom and stuck her head under a tap, gulping water. But it didn't take long before she had to face the consequences of her actions from her family head, the staff member in charge of her.
The next thing I do remember is standing there for a strip search with my family head and my roommate, standing in front of them and having to, you know, spin around. And that was pretty violating. I never even changed clothes in front of my roommate.
A former staff member confirmed with me that kids were strip searched after being caught running away.
So after all that you've been through, you get...
Yes.
Strip searched.
Yeah, that was... Yes, and I was scratched clearly from all this brush and bruised. Yeah, you stand there and you stand facing forward and then turn around.
I mean, we're really, like, it's remarkable that we're looking at a spot there that you could have died at.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, and it, you know, I have to say, it makes me wonder about Daniel.
After Daniel ran away, his parents, Wayne and Lisa, paid for 2 searches of the backside. But standing here, it's clear what a daunting task that would be, to try and find a person, or even a body. After Melissa's ordeal on the mountainside, after all the dehydration, the gunshots, the pain and the cold, after finding herself back where she started, after a strip search in front of staff and fellow residents, there was still one more thing Melissa had to do. She had to go back into a rap session, the very sessions that made her run in the first place. She had to go back and confess. Melissa says she's still haunted by this place. After our tour, she sent me a list of the ways she says her adult life is still shaped by her time here. The list reads in part, dissociate easily, difficulty with intimacy and connecting to others, ever-present and looming sense that I will get in trouble still, or that there's an impending crisis around the corner, trust and boundary issues, relationship with family and friends irreparably broken to a certain extent, barometer for detecting a threatening situation, is a little unhinged.
All right, let's drive on out of here.
That's the last time I'll see that mountain for a while.
next time on The Lost Kids.
It deals with all kinds of things from your childhood. And the child, the inner child, is one of the basic things there. There's a thing that they used to say is if you quit paying attention to the child inside of you, you'll die.
I mean, by today's standard, it would all be illegal. You're not allowed to touch students at all. We were always all over each other.
Did it feel strange to have adults mixed in with the kids, or was that just part
strange.
Of...
Dude, we were in, like, a psychological sandstorm.
CEDU was not a therapeutic community. It was a school where kids came to learn how to grow up.
This podcast was produced by David McDougall, Kathleen Goldhar, and me. Our associate producer is Max Miller. Sound design and mixing by Mitchell Stewart. Additional producing by Medium Anonymous and Todd Nilssen. Executive producing by Amanda McPhillips, Nathan Ament, Kathleen Goldhar, and myself. This is a UCP Audio podcast. For more information, go to our website, ucpaudio.com.